Prime Minister of tiny Montenegro aside so he could get to the front of the photo ops. And this, at an organization built on unity and consensus, a public tongue-lashing.
23 of the 28 member nations are still not paying what they should be paying and what they are supposed to be paying for their defense. This is not fair to the people and taxpayers of the United States. And many of these nations owe massive amounts of money from past years and not paying.
To the president's supporters, that's a welcome and trademark moment. Ditch the diplo speak, call out the freeloaders. To his critics, an unnecessary and gratuitous lecture and a public gift to Vladimir Putin, for whom NATO is public enemy number one, and any sign of allied discord is a propaganda tool. So which is it, or is it both?
Yeah, I think it's probably both. I mean, in a weird way, it does sort of send a message domestically back home. Hey, listen, you know, the guy at the end of the bar, who I think Trump really does represent, this is the kind of thing that they've been talking about for years. Why don't the Europeans, you know, pay up? Why don't, you know, why do we have so many military installations all over the world? But there's a problem there, which is it's not really how it actually works. You know, it's, these aren't sort of dues. There's no debt being owed by these countries. They're all sort of paid up, but there are sort of guidelines by which these nations are supposed to be paying. It's just not exactly what the president said.
And the incoming from the Europeans was that the president has no grace, that he's won this argument. That President Clinton raised this, President Bush raised this, President Obama raised this. It's actually started to improve late in the Obama administration, but during the campaign and after the election, that the NATO allies, most of them, many of them anyway, have said we will spend more on our defense. That's the point. You spend a percentage of your gross domestic product on defense. That he was winning this already, and he could have said thank you, but I'm going to keep an eye on this. He could have delivered the same message, but they thought he was kind of a bore about it.
Right. Well, European leaders will tell you that they started doing this before Trump was even in the White House. So, you know, maybe he's just cracking the whip and being more brusque about it. But, you know, that's kind of, like you said a minute ago, like this is the classic, you know, Americans aren't Europeans. They're graceful and, you know, drink their tea with their finger crooked. And we, you know, we are the Wild West and we rope steer. And it's a very different sort of approach. And it's almost caricaturous right now how stark that difference is on display. But, you know.
And the style of Trump, the push to the Prime Minister of Montenegro, the American president is supposed to be up front for the photo op. That's how it works. It's how he does things that sometimes offend people. But on the substance, one of the incoming that was most interesting to me was that the president came from Saudi Arabia, where he received a commitment from the Saudi government to crack down on terror financing, to crack down on promoting extremism. Now, if that happens, the president will have changed the world. The problem for the other NATO leaders is they have heard this repeatedly for years, and the Saudis have not followed through. So when the president said this, many of them found him to be naive.
There I spent much time with King Salman, a wise man who wants to see things get much better rapidly. The leaders of the Middle East have agreed at this unprecedented meeting to stop funding the radical ideology that leads to this horrible terrorism all over the globe.
Many of those leaders would tell you they had moderate Islam in their European countries, and the Saudis, over the last 15 or 20 years, have funded mosques that have become much more radical. They view the Saudis as a problem, and they just simply, again, if the Saudis follow through on what they promised President Obama, I mean, President Trump, the world will change. But those leaders think, come on, buddy, you got head.
I mean, you could practically hear the eye rolls as he said that, because I think it's also the juxtaposition of the tongue lashing to our allies who are fighting with us in the Middle East, who came to our defense after 9/11, and the effusive praise for the Saudis, and before the Saudis have even really done anything. I mean, they've made a sort of verbal commitment to it, but they haven't yet done it. And I think that there is some weariness that the president is hoping that this deal comes through, but the proof is going to be in the pudding. This is a long game. It's not just you sign a piece of paper. It's like, what are they actually going to do to stem this really deep problem that pits you know, sects of Islam against each other? There is not just a piece of paper you can sign that can do away with that.
And there's a sense of naivete, I think, about this, because three times in briefings, senior administration officials said the president has united the Muslim world against extremism. That is simply wishful thinking. If that would be reality, that would be amazing. But I mean, I think that there is this sense of just giving one speech in Riyadh does not solve problems.
It only speaks to about half the Muslim world also. And I mean, remember, King Salman is like he's a spin artist like anybody else, and he's found a friend right now. I mean, they were pissed at the Obama administration towards the end of the presidency because Obama made a turn towards Iran. He did not step outside in front of the moving train that was that JASTA bill for the 9/11 victims. He just kind of let Congress do its thing. They were very, very angry about the way the situation was. And they see a friend and an ally in Trump. They flatter him. He is learning on the job. He's not, you know, that aware of it.
And so he's billboards come across Riyadh. It was unbelievable.
It was incredible.
So much different than President Obama going there in 2009. I was on that trip as well. It was.
They bring out the glowing orb. Right. I mean, everything, right?
So
I mean, but really, I mean, it is they knew how to cater to him, and he is responding in kind because he is learning on the job, and so have you know, and it's got an inimical relationship between his party and the Iranian leadership. And,
sure, there's a parallelism here, I think, with President Obama, which is the view that both presidents share, that sort of by force of their own personality and their sort of own uniqueness, that they can do something that has been bedeviling leaders in that part of the world for hundreds, thousands of years sometimes.